Hello my friends, and welcome to watch my next review, which is today devoted to one of the most interesting phones of the latest months. It's Jiayu S3. And first let me tell you several words about this interesting phone. Jiayu S3 is the best of the Jiayu phones to date, and this phone it's very interesting by its technical specs. It has 5.5 inches FullHD screen. It's based on the latest MediaTek MTK 6752 8-core processor, and this processor is interesting not only because it's 8-core processor, but also because this processor is based on the latest 64-bit architecture. It's ARM v8, Cortex A53 architecture. It supports 64-bit instructions, and it's completely supported only by the latest Android 5.0. Unfortunately, we don't have Android 5.0 yet at this phone, but I think in about 1 or 2 months we may expect such firmware from Jiayu. Also, this phone has 2 or 3 GB of random access memory. I have 2 GB version on test today, but the 3 GB version is also available to date. The other difference is that the 3 GB version supports NFC. All the other technical specs are the same, and we may take a look at the box. Maybe you'll be able to see it. So this phone is based on the 8-core 1.7 GHz MediaTek MT6752 processor. It's system on chip. Also, it has Mali T760 MP2 700 MHz GPU, which is rather powerful. You'll be able to see it. This version has 2 GB of random access memory, a 5.5 inches IPS OGS FullHD screen. Also, it has frontal camera 5 megapixels. The back main camera is 13 megapixels and it's based on the Sony IMX214 famous image sensor. Also, this phone has a rather decent battery. It's 3000 mAh capacity according to Jiayu. And the operating system for today it's Android 4.4.4, but Android 5.0 is expected soon. Also, this phone is interesting because it supports 4G. It supports both TD-LTE and FDD-LTE, so it should work worldwide. It supports most of the 3rd and 4th generation cell networks. And the maximum speed in 3G networks, it should be up to 42 megabits per second, and for 4G, for LTE, it should be up to 150 megabits per second. So the speed is really, really nice. Also, what is interesting about this phone, it supports 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi, and it's not only traditional BGN, but it also supports even the fastest AC version of the Wi-Fi networks. What is also interesting, at the same time it supports 3 different navigation systems. It's not only GPS as the previous versions of the MediaTek processor, but also its GLONASS, its Russian system, and also its Beidou, the second version of Beidou, its Chinese global system. And what I should say, the satellites of all 3 systems are available here in Ukraine even, so actually they're available worldwide, so the navigation on this phone should be rather good. Also, it supports USB 2.0 OTG. It has standard 3.5 mm plug for headphones and microphone, and some other interesting technical specs. Let's talk about them a bit later. Now let's take a look inside the box. As you can see, the box is made from a hard cardboard. It's very hard and it protects the phone very well, so no problems here. The documentation in Chinese, the European version of this phone will contain the English documentation. And the box itself will have the technical specs in English too, so you may get actually the English version of this phone. Also, what we have here is a standard set of accessories. It's adapter for European plug, rather good quality. A charger with Chinese or American plug, as you can see, and again the European version of this phone will have the European plug, so you may try and order the European version of this phone if you like. The charger is completely weak, it only 1000 milliamperes, so the charging will take rather long. And the standard data and charging cable. Both charger and cables, as you can see, they are white and the phone itself is black, so it's a bit a little surprise from Jiayu, I should say. But I don't think it's very important. Now it's time to take a look at the phone itself. Okay, so what we have here at the front panel. First, it's 5 megapixels frontal camera. It's a rather good quality. Next, you see it's two colors LED indicator. It supports green and red color. It's a speaker for the phone. Here we have two sensors. It's a proximity and light sensors. And three touch buttons. Here it's standards for Android, menu, home and back buttons. And of course, a huge 5.5 inches Full HD IPS OGS screen with very good quality. Also, what we have here, it's standard 3.5 millimeters plug for headphones and microphone. It's a secondary microphone which is used for noise reduction first, and it's used for video recording, for stereo sound in video. Nothing here. The main microphone, it's for phone, micro USB 2.0 for charging and data transfer. And here we have two buttons, it's power button and volume up and down rocker. And what I should say, the buttons are made from metal. The phone looks rather nice, I should say. It's symmetrical. What is also interesting, maybe the gamers will pay attention to this. The materials are rather good. Also, what I should say, they are rather pleasant. The design is comparatively plain, but I like it. As you can see, this Jiayu sign is made of metal. A big net of the speakers. And this phone has two speakers, what is interesting. It's a main 13 megapixels camera, which is based on the Sony IMX214 sensor, which is famous and very high quality sensor. And what is also interesting, it has two LEDs for flash. So it's better than for most of the other phones. Now let's take a look under the cover, what we have here. What is interesting, the IMA and certificate and the quality check mark are situated on the cover of the phone, not under the battery. The phone supports two SIM cards, both of them are micro SIMs, so it's a SIM1 and SIM2, and of course it supports the TF card or micro SD card up to 64 gigabytes, maybe even more. What is also interesting, you can see the battery is different from the previous phones of Jiayu. It has almost the same capacity, it's a typical capacity, as I can see it's 3000 mAh and the maximum capacity it should be 3100 mAh, so maybe it has a little bit higher capacity than the batteries of the previous phones made by Jiayu, and the form is also a bit different, but nothing very special, not much difference I should say. Also, the phone is comparatively small compared to the competitors. I have a couple of phones to compare. For instance, this is Xiaomi Redmi Note, which is a very good phone made by Xiaomi, and it has the same size of the screen, it's 5.5 inches, but Xiaomi is much bigger in all dimensions and it's much heavier, what I should say. Xiaomi weighs 200 grams and Jiayu weighs only 160 grams. And of course it's smaller, it's lighter and it's better in this respect. And this is on the left side, it's THL5000. This phone has smaller screen, it's only 5 inches. But all the other specs are very similar. It's based on also 8-core processor and it's overclocked version of the MTK6592. It's overclocked up to 2.0 GHz, so the frequency of CPU of this phone is even higher than for Jiayu S3, but Jiayu S3 has a newer processor and it's based on more advanced architecture, so it will be interesting to compare two of these phones, which one will be faster. So this is dimensions, as you can see, of course 5.5 inches Jiayu S3 is bigger than THL5000, but it's somewhat smaller than most of the other 5.5 inches phones, including Xiaomi Redmi. And now let's turn the phone on. A little trick. The phone supports gestures and it supports smart touches. So you may turn the phone on just by tapping twice the screen of the phone, which is very interesting. And you may turn it on by widget, as you can see. So you may not use these buttons at all if you like. But of course you may turn it on and off by buttons also if you like. So here is the screen of our Hero. You can see the interface is very very fluent and don't forget it's a full HD screen. Now let's take a closer look at the firmware of this phone. I should say the firmware is a bit different from the standard Android 4.4.4. There are some specificities made by Jiayu, and in most cases they're so to say stolen by the Jiayu from the other manufacturers like Samsung, like Lenovo, like Oppo, like Xiaomi and so on, but still these differences are rather useful. I like these features introduced by Jiayu, so it's rather good. Also, what is interesting here, and let's take a look at the settings. The phone supports SIMs, so you may make it look a bit different if you like. Nothing very special here, as you can see. But phone supports, as you can see, gesture sensing and smart wake. What is interesting. Also, phone is rooted out of the factory, and you may turn and turn on and turn off root just from the security menu. You can see it here, and you may also allow the root for separate programs if you like. So it's very useful and convenient. And here is the version of firmware. As you can see, it's Android 4.4.4, and this firmware is Chinese version of the firmware from the 4th of February. It's the latest firmware to date, but we may expect the newer firmwares very soon. By the way, from the box, this firmware doesn't support the Google Play and Google services, but I have installed the firmware upgraded by the ROM makers. It's firmware from the NIDROM, and you may find the link to this firmware in the description to this video. The European version of firmware, it's from 5th of February, and it has already pre-installed version of Play Market. The version of Android is the same, Android 4.4.4. So let's take a look. Let's check the root first. As you can see, the device is rooted, and I didn't have to root it by myself, so it was rooted out of the factory. Now let's take a look in the gallery. You can see the screen. The view angles are good because it's a modern IPS screen. Of course, there should be no problems with this. The performance is perfect, as you can expect. It is also interesting, as you can see, it supports gestures. I don't even touch the screen. Now let's take a look at the Google Store. It works without any problems, as well as all the other Google services. And the performance is good also, so no problems here at all. Let's take a look at the performance in the internet. I set the phone to work with the full versions of sites, not the mobile versions, because it's powerful enough, as you can see, to work with any versions of sites. And the screen resolution is, I should say, higher than for most of the notebooks even. For instance, my new notebook, you can see it here, it has the same screen resolution, Full HD, as this phone. And this notebook has only 10 screen, while this phone has IPS OGS screen, which is of course much better by many specifications, including the viewing angles, for instance. So as you can see, you won't have any problems with internet. Everything works fine. And very, very fluently. So you can see that everything here is very fluent and fast. So the usage of internet will be very pleasant with this phone. Very nice. Okay, now let's check the large PDF files. I've downloaded a couple of them for you to check. You can see this file is about 43.5 megabytes and it's a really huge PDF file. You can see the number of pages here. It's 5612 pages. So this file is simply huge. And you can see phone works with this file very, very fluently. What I should say, of course, it's the best variant among those I tested before. And this file has a lot of pictures, not only text, and still, as you can see, it works very fluently. Almost perfectly fluent, especially for such a huge file. So that's it. Okay, now let's take a look at CPU Z. And you can see we have, take a look at the frequency of CPU, by the way. You can see it, it's 1859 MHz. And this is interesting because you can see the minimum clock speed of this processor is 468 MHz. And the maximum frequency is 1.69 GHz. But if only one or two cores are active, the maximum frequency may be even higher than the standard maximum frequency, and it's not 1.69 GHz, but it's 1.859, so it's 1859 MHz, which is almost 200 MHz higher than the standard maximum frequency. So it's kind of overclocking technology, dynamic overclocking, like the Intel processors and AMD processors use such a technology. So it seems like MediaTek now uses such technology also. And you can see we have Cortex A53 architecture. So it's 64 bits architecture, and the GPU is Mali T760. Here is the system information. You can see it, the amount of random access memory, internal storage. This phone has 16 gigabytes of internal storage, so it's good enough, and of course it supports the memory card, which is very good. The battery. The capacity of battery in this phone is 3000 milliamperes, and let's talk about the battery life. So the battery life is better than I expected for such a big screen, and the battery capacity is comparatively average for such a huge screen and 8-core processor. It's good, it's okay, but it's not perfect. For instance, the THL5000 I showed it to you, Earlier it has 5000 milliampere battery, and this phone only has 3000 milliampere battery, and it also has a more powerful processor and the bigger screen. But the battery life is good. It's about the same as for the, for instance, Xiaomi Redmi Note. Redmi Note has a little bit higher capacity of battery. It's around 100 or 200 milliampere higher, and it also has 8 cores processor, and the frequency of this processor is also almost the same. It's 1.67 gigahertz for MTK6592 in Redmi Note, and it's a little bit higher, 1.69 gigahertz in Jiayu S3, which I test today. So the screen is also the same. It's 5.5 inches, but again, the processor in Xiaomi is much weaker, which we will see a little bit later. And the screen in Xiaomi has a lower resolution. It's only HD resolution, 720 by 1280 pixels. So the performance, of course, should be heavier for Jiayu S3. But the battery life is almost the same. It's around the same, and what I can see, it's about 4 to 5 hours of heavy gaming, three-dimensional heavy games. It's about 5 to 6 hours of simple games, and if they're very simple, it's up to 10 hours and maybe even more. It's about 8 to 10 hours of Wi-Fi internet, and about the video, it's about the same also. And if you read the book, it will be up to maybe even 15 hours. And again, the battery life depends on the screen brightness. It's very important because the screen is very big here, and the maximum brightness is also very high, what I should say. So I recommend you to use the minimum acceptable brightness of the screen to get the better results of using and the better battery life. This phone has some temperature sensor in battery, of course. You can see the temperature now is 32 degrees Celsius. And also this phone supports a lot of different thermal sensors. Most of them are built in into the system on chip, and some of them I can see they are built in into the motherboard of this phone. Also, you can see it has a lot of other sensors. We'll check them out in another program too. So it has the accelerometer, proximity sensor, light sensor, gyroscope, orientation sensor, magnetometer, rotation vector sensor, gravity sensor, and linear acceleration sensor. So a lot of sensors, all of them working. There are some minor problems with light sensor and magnetometer. It's like compass, electronic compass sensor. Sometimes the work is not very perfect. Maybe it will be corrected by the future firmware. The light sensor sometimes may stuck on like 100 luxes or 200 luxes or even higher, but it doesn't stop working at all, but it may cause some problems with the auto brightness on this phone. The magnetometer works good but not perfect. I'll show it to you a bit later. Okay, so now let's check the sensors with another program. This one is more precise. You can see all these sensors work fine, as you can see. So that's it. Now let's check the compass. You can see how it works. It's not always perfect. We have north somewhere there, so generally it shows it good, but you can see sometimes it misses the direction and it needs some time to catch it again. So that's it. Now let's check the screen again. I wanted to show you the minimum and maximum brightness of the screen. Actually, this is the minimum brightness, which is set by the standard settings, and the minimum brightness is not so low. I should say for the total complete darkness it's a bit too high. The maximum brightness is very high, and with such brightness the phone may be used anywhere under the direct sun, no problems at all. I think it's from like 400s to 500s of nits, so the maximum brightness is very high. But the minimum brightness may be set to lower values. There is a program like Rudim. You'll find the link to this program in the description to this video, and with this program you may lower the minimum brightness to very very low level, and with such low brightness of the screen you may use the phone anywhere, even in complete total darkness, no problem at all here. So in this respect the phone is very good also. And in all the other respects the screen is very good. What I should say, the viewing angles are virtually perfect, no problems at all. Here the brightness is good, as I already said, no dead or broken pixels. Black color is very black. Well, with the maximum brightness it's not totally black, it's rather gray, but the uniformity of black is very good. So actually I found no special problems with the screen. The screen is very good, and it's OGS of course, so I don't recommend you to broke the screen, even if the screen itself will be okay. You have to change the whole module, both the screen and the touch screen. So that's it. So the screen is very good, and let's continue with the next section. Now let's check the YouTube. This phone has a Full HD screen and the picture quality will be perfect of course, and it supports a Full HD video in YouTube, so no problems at all here. Let's take a look at some video with nice girls. Well, maybe this girl is not so nice. Let's check something else. You can see the quality of video, it's a Full HD. And of course no problems at all here. Everything works perfectly. By the way, let's check the sound. The sound quality is good. What I should say is the phone has two speakers. They are situated here and here. so the sound quality is a bit better than for most of the other Chinese phones. So, as I already said, phone has two speakers. They are situated here and here, so two main speakers. And the sound quality, as you may noticed, it's quite good, so no problems with this at all. But maybe it's not perfect, nothing very special. It's a normal, higher than average quality of sound, but nothing very special, so to say. The sound in the speaker, in this speaker, it's a phone speaker, it's also quite good. The microphone works okay. And I tried several good headphones with this phone. It was Panasonic RP-HTF-890. It was COS Porta Pro, and it was Xiaomi Pistons 2. It's very nice headphones made by Xiaomi. All these headphones are very different, but the sound quality was good. I liked this quality of sound in this phone. There are trembles, there are basses, so it's okay. Now, about the connections in this phone, I couldn't enter the engineer mode in traditional way from the mobile uncle, so I had to download the so-called MTK engineering mode program from the Google Play Store, and it works without any problems actually. So you can make the same thing, and let's check the bonds for the first SIM. It's, you can see it, the white bands may be turned off and on. I turned off those bands not used in my area, in my country, in Ukraine. But they are all operable. So this phone has more both UMTS bands and more LTE bands than most of the other phones. You can see it supports 2000 MHz, 1900 MHz, 8050, 8000 and 900 MHz WCDMA, and several bands of LTE. It's band 3, band 7, band 20, and several of the Chinese bands, 38, 39, 40 and 41. The second SIM unfortunately only support GSM, so mind it. Now, let's try and check the sensor, the touch screen of this phone. And it supports a lot of touches. You can see it's 10 touches, simultaneous 10 touches. And I like the touchscreen very good. It's very precise. It works very well. As you can see. And it supports, you can see it, even 5 touches. Perfectly, absolutely. No errors here. The whole area works without any problems here. So the touchscreen is very good, but there is small minor problem with this touchscreen, and the problem is it doesn't like the no-name chargers. So if you use it with good chargers, with its native original Jiayu charger, when you charge it from USB port of the computer. I also tried it with Xiaomi Redmi Note charger, no problems at all. But when I tried my no-name charger, it has rather good quality. I tried it with many other phones and tablets and had no problems with most of them. But this phone shows a little bit inadequate work of touchscreen with such chargers, so I recommend you to use the good quality charger with this phone. not to have any problems with touchscreen. Now let's continue and check the Wi-Fi. It's another positive side of this phone. You can see how many Wi-Fi networks it can see, and the signal quality of my network is very good. It's usually from 35 to 40 dBm, and it's a very good signal quality. And you can see the number of networks, so no problems here at all. Also, this phone supports 5 GHz networks, and it also supports AC networks, the latest standard of Wi-Fi, so the speed will be just tremendous. It will be very, very fast when using AC Wi-Fi networks. I'll show you the screens a little bit later. Also, Bluetooth works without any problems. I tried it with this computer, with my notebook. I tried it with different phones, and everything works perfectly. Absolutely no problems. Also, I wanted to show you the results of navigation test. I can't test it right now because I'm inside the building, but just several meters from here near the window, not even outside the building but inside the building, I got such a result. As you can see, the phone can see 14 satellites. Most of them are GPS satellites, of course, 10 GPS satellites, 3 GLONASS satellites, and even one Chinese Beidou satellite I caught here. It's satellite number 214, but I also saw satellite number 210. So at least two of Chinese satellites are here. So maybe seen here in Ukraine. So this phone at the same time may use simultaneously three different navigation systems. Of course, the basic navigation system is still GPS, but in some areas you may also see many different satellites, both GLONASS and Beidou. So, and also you can see several of the satellites have very good signal quality, and I repeat, it's inside the building, so outside the building the result will be even better. So no problems with this also. And I wanted to show you the results of Wi-Fi test. You can see this is result, it's near the router, just maybe 20 centimeters near the router, and the signal quality is -23 maybe dBm. It's a very, very good result, maybe the best result. This result is, it's about 1 meter from my router. The router is TP-Link, one of the good routers. Again, you can see the number of networks, and the it's through the wall, it's behind the concrete wall. So 1 meter away behind the concrete wall, and still -34 about dBm. Also very good result. This result is for, it's about 6 meters and one wall. Again. And this result, this result is 6 meters and one wall. And this result, it's about 10 meters and I think it's 3 walls, concrete walls in diagonal. So this about 10 meters away and 3 walls away from the router, and still it's about -49 dBm. And this result guarantees a very high transfer speed. So the speed will be very, very good. So this is also the result, it's 10 meters away. So all the wireless protocols, as well as the phone calls, and as well as the data transfer through the cell networks, all work okay, no problems at all here. And now let's continue with considering the cameras. The phone has a 5 megapixels frontal camera. It's an ordinary camera, but the quality is good. I should say, even with low illumination, the picture quality is rather good. It's sometimes a bit slow, but the quality is good. So it's quite okay for the Skype and other similar programs, and it's okay to make some selfies. But it's better, of course, if there is enough light to make some selfies by the frontal camera. The back camera is more interesting. As I already said, it's based on the Sony IMX214 XMORE image sensor, and it's rather big image sensor. It's 1 to 3.06, so it's only a bit smaller than the sensors of the most compact cameras, and the lens system is comparatively advanced also, and the camera has two, as you can see, it has two LEDs. So the flashlight, so to say, in this phone should be also better than the flashlight of most other Chinese and not only phones. So it's difficult to show the quality of camera in video, of course, but I'll try to do it. And to see more, check my text review. The link to the text review is a full-size photo from this phone. You may find it in the description to this video, so check it please. So some photos. This photo is made with no light. It's only uses the flashlight of this phone. You can see the picture quality is better than you could expect. Okay, so this photo is made in good shooting conditions. It's not so much sun, but it's day, and the conditions are rather good for photo. You can see the quality of the picture in the center of the file. In the center of the picture, they are very good. In the corners, the quality is worse, of course, as it's usual situation for phones, so the picture quality in corners is usually worse than in the center. But the geometric distortions are comparatively low. They are lower than for most of the other phones, and there are no chromatic aberrations. Usually in this place you could be able to see the chromatic aberrations, but you can't see them because I think the software is made to remove them. So it's a positive thing for Jiayu. Also, you can see how gesture sensor works. You can see it rather good. I don't know what is the reason of this, but it works. This picture is made again inside the building, inside the room, with flash, but also there is one lamp was enabled. It's about 32 watts economic lamp. It's about 150 watts for normal lamp. This picture was made in complete darkness. It's late in the night, and the picture quality is not so perfect, unfortunately, of course. You can see it's a SO400. By the way, these pictures are made by the camera CF5. It's not the native original application. This application allows you to choose some settings, like for instance ISO and so on, so I chose it manually. The perfect conditions for shooting, and you can see the picture quality is rather good. Again, in corners it's not so good, but in the center of the screen it's very good. And this is a macro picture. about 10 cm away with flashlight, built-in flashlight of the phone. You can see the picture quality is very good, what I should say, no problems at all. These photos are also made by this phone. You can see the details level is rather good. So you can see all the signs, no problems at all. So that's it. So the cameras are good. In this phone, the main camera maybe doesn't show the whole potential of the sensor which is used in this phone, but maybe the future firmwares will add some functionality. At the moment, it only supports video in Full HD 30 frames per second. Theoretically, this phone, this system on chip and this sensor allow to shoot the Full HD 60 frames per second video, but it doesn't support it at the moment, so maybe the future firmwares will add some functionality and will improve the quality of the picture. But again, for today, the quality of photos is quite good. No serious problems. And now let's check the performance. It's time to check the performance, and first, of course, it's Antutu benchmark. You can see the results. It's 40,219 points. The other users with European firmware were able to get about 1,000 points more. So the usual result for the European firmware is even higher, and it's about 41,300 points. But even such result, it's higher than 40,000 points. And you can see the details, all tests shows a very good results. What I should say is that this phone in most tests, including the most important test like the CPU performance and three-dimensional graphics performance, it shows 1.5 times higher results in CPU tests and about 1.5-1.6 times higher results in GPU test. If compared with normal version of the previous processor MTK6592, this processor is about up to 70% faster in CPU tests and almost twice as fast in a GPU test. If we consider the overclocked version, it's 2.0 GHz MTK6592T. This processor has even higher clock frequencies than the tested MTK6752, and still it's much slower, about 1.5 times slower than this phone, and the results are also worse. So for instance, Xiaomi Redmi Note, which has much lower resolution of the screen and about the same frequency of processor, it shows about 31,000 to 32,000 points in this test. So even lower results with much lower resolution of the screen. The THL5000, which has even faster processor, it's 2.0 GHz 8 cores versus 1.69 GHz in this processor, again 8 cores, it shows about 30,000 points in tests, so it's 10,000 points lower than this phone with the same resolution of the screen. But again, I should say that the core tests like the CPU integrand float point, the RAM operation and RAM speed, and 3D graphic tests shows almost twice as high results as the previous generation of the processors. There is also MTK6595 processor, which is very fast. It's based on the Cortex A17 architecture, which is performance architecture one of the latest architecture, but this processor has even more advanced architecture because it's already ARM v8, when all the previous processor had ARM v7 architecture, then this architecture is already ARM v8. So this processor is maybe slower than, for instance, MTK6595, but it's much faster than MTK6592, and it's much more advanced than any of the previous MTK processors. So that's it. And now let's continue with the next test. It's 3D Mark. Let's check it. I've checked it with iStorm Unlimited. And here is the result. You can see the result of iStorm Unlimited. This test is always executed in 720p resolution, which is 1280 by 720 pixels. So it may be compared with all the other phones, and as you can see, the result of iStorm Unlimited is 10,730 points, which is a very good result. For instance, Xiaomi Redmi Note in the same test, iStorm Unlimited with the same resolution of the screen, had only about 6,000 points, even a little bit lower result than 6,000 points. And the overclocked THL5000 in the same resolution had 7,000 points. And this phone, Jiayu S3, with this, in the same test, with the same resolution, has 10,730 points. So it's more than 1.5 times higher results than for THL5000. So you can see the performance in 3D graphics is more than 15% higher even than for the overclocked version of MTK6592. And compared with the normal version of MTK6592, which has almost the same CPU frequencies, the results compared to this version are almost twice as high. So it's a very, very good result, and you can see it's 4 stars, which is also very good. The normal iStorm is completely maxed out, as you can see. So that's it. Okay, and now let's continue with one of the most beautiful three-dimensional tests. It's Epic Citadel. And what is interesting about this phone is that it's capable to run it in ultra high quality mode, because the previous MTK processors were not able to run it in ultra high quality mode, except for MTK6595, of course. But even MTK6592 wasn't able to run the highest quality mode because it was equipped with the obsolete Mali-415 GPU, which was fast but wasn't advanced enough. So you can see the performance is ultra high quality, and of course 100% resolution. And let's run the test to check the quality. You can see that it's ultra high quality mode. The picture quality is very, very good. It's just perfect. Of course, it's Full HD resolution. The resolution is very high. And the performance is very good too, what I should say. You can see the performance at the moment is over 50 frames per second, even in the highest quality mode, even in Full HD resolution. So phone shows very good results. And here is the result. As you can see, the average frames per second is 39.2, the maximum possible quality mode, and the result is almost 40 frames per second, which is a very, very good result. Of course, both the performance and quality are very good here. In the lower quality modes, the performance will be close to maximum, close to 60 frames per second, because the performance is more than enough to run this test in a performance mode, in high performance mode and high quality mode. And only the ultra high quality mode may reduce the performance a bit. Okay, let's stop here and continue with the last performance test. It's another complete performance test, the Llama. So here are the results of the Llama, and let's check them in details. You can see that the metal score is 1124 points, the multi-core score is 1632 points, and the Chrome browser score is almost 3000 points, which is also very good. So let's check it and compare with the other phones. And you can see the results in metal subtest. The results of Jiayu S3 are higher than for the HTC One and lower than for LG Nexus 5. And also they are lower than for the Samsung Galaxy S5, HTC One M8, LG G3 and OnePlus One. But still, the results are quite nice. You can see it's much higher than for Nexus 7, for instance, and HTC One. So the results are good. Next, continuous multi-core. And in this test, as you can see, the results are even better. It's about the same result as for the Samsung Galaxy S5, which has also very powerful processor. And we should consider that this processor installed in the Jiayu S3, it supports 64-bit instructions, so it supports Android 5.0. So in the next version of Android, which we are going to receive quite soon, I believe that we will have even the better test results. So today it's comparable with HTC One LG Nexus 5. It's even faster than this phone, and it's about equal to Samsung Galaxy S5, and only a bit slower than LG G3, OnePlus One, and HTC One M8. And let's check the Chrome browser test. You can see the result. It's the best result among all the other phones. So it's faster than Nexus 5, it's faster than Galaxy S5, it's faster than HTC One M8, and it's even faster than OnePlus One, based on the fastest variant of Snapdragon 801. So the results are very good again, and they will be even better in the next version of the Android 5.0, which we are going to receive in just about maybe 1 month or 2 months. So that's it with test results, and now let's check the games. Of course, let's start with Angry Birds. Any two-dimensional games, what I should say, they are too simple for these phones. Let's reduce the sound volume a bit. Of course, the Angry Birds are too simple for these phones. Of course, the frame rate is maximum possible frame rate, so you will have no problems with any two-dimensional games. So something like that. You can see both the game and interface work very fluently and fine. Let's continue with Cut the Rope 2. This game is a bit more advanced. It's also a two-dimensional game, but it's newer and it's somewhat bit more advanced. The level of graphics is also a bit higher, as you can see. So and the performance is perfect. The graphic looks nice and the performance is still perfect. You can see it, both the game and interface work very well. And now let's continue with the three-dimensional games. First of them will be comparatively simple. It's Subway Surfers. Of course, with this game we won't have any problems. Because for today it's comparatively simple. The textures are rather low quality. And there are not so many polygons here. So this game is comparatively simple and the performance, of course, it's perfect. As you can see, no problems at all. Everything is fast and very fluent. The next game should be comparatively simple, but in reality it's much more advanced and it has a lot of three-dimensional graphics elements, high quality three-dimensional graphic elements. So everything here is in 3D. And this little boy is also three-dimensional model. So this game is here. But again, no problems, as you can see. Everything is quite fluent here. So everything is fine. And the load time is very fast, what I should say, compared to the other phones. Now the minion rush. This is an advanced 3D game with rather heavy graphics, so let's check it. This game is usually rather slow on most of the devices, not only the MediaTek based phones, but also the Intel based phones and tablets, and even the Qualcomm based devices. But as you can see in this case, the performance is very good. It's very fluent despite the high level of graphics, you can see it. There are many polygons, a lot of different textures, a lot of different special effects again. And it's still perfect. So you can see no problems with the performance. So we can continue with the other games. By the way, it's something similar to Xiaomi, as you can see, and you may clear the random access memory by one button. So this feature is kind of received from Xiaomi. Now, let's continue with the advanced, with another advanced three-dimensional game. It's Dungeon Hunter 4. This is comparatively new game released last year with rather nice graphics. A lot of enemies, a lot of textures, a lot of objects. And as you can see, the graphic level is rather high. But the performance is perfect. Again, as you can see, it's very, very fluent. I think it's about 60 frames per second. So no problems with performance at all. You can see how fluent it is. Yeah, So that's it. And the heaviest game for today is N.O.V.A 3. The game which has one of the most advanced 3D-dimensional graphics among all the other Android-based games. So N.O.V.A. And let's check it, how it looks like. You can see the level of graphics.
Keep up the suppressive fire! Soldier, what the hell are you? Damn it, sorry, Sergeant, not see your wreck. Is your team nearby?
It's somewhat similar to maybe even one of the best of PC games, Crysis. The perfect textures, a lot of objects, a lot of enemies, and so on and so on and so on. And it's very fluent. Still it's very fluent, as you can see. It works very, very well. I'll be dead in this game soon, of course. But just to show you, you can see how it works. And it works very, very well. And you can see the level of graphics. And the performance is maybe not 60 frames per second, but it's about maybe 40 frames per second, no problems at all. So that's it, I think, about the gaming. You can see how good the performance is. And now it's time to make some conclusions about this phone. Of course, it was one of the most awaited, so to say, phones of this year, at least of the first part of this year. And it's because of several reasons. First, of course, it's the technical specs, because this phone has a big and high resolution screen with very high quality. It has a very powerful and newest processor, which not only much faster than the previous generation of MediaTek processors, but also it supports the 64 bits instructions. It's compatible with Android 5.0 and it has a lot of other positive sides. Also, it has a much more powerful GPU than the previous generation of comparatively budgetary processors. So compared to MTK6595, it may be a little bit slower, both in CPU and GPU terms, but compared to MTK6592, even its overclocked version, this processor, MTK6752, it's much faster in both CPU and GPU terms. The other characteristics, the other technical specs are also very good, and they include 2 or even 3 GB of random access memory, 16 GB of flash memory, support of memory card up to 64 and more GB. It has two cameras, frontal camera is 5 megapixels and the back camera is 13 megapixels with dual LED flash and with a very advanced Sony IMX214 image sensor. And it has a 3000 mAh battery and it supports not only 3G like WCDMA, but also it supports TE and FDD-LTE, and the downloading speed is up to 150 megabits per second. And also it supports the most advanced and the newest version of Wi-Fi, it's AC standard, with the downloading speed of higher than 400 megabits per second. So there are many positive sides in this phone. I would say the design is nice. It has a metal frame, it has a metal buttons. It supports two SIM cards, of course, as most of the other similar phones. And the advanced version even supports the NFC. It supports the smart wake function. It supports the gestures. So I would say it's a very advanced phone. And the performance is comparable with, for instance, Samsung Galaxy S5. And while Samsung Galaxy S5 costs about $500, this phone only costs $180 in 2 GB version and about $210 in 3 GB version. So it's comparatively inexpensive. And by the technical specs, it may be compared with the best and the fastest phones of 2014. For instance, Samsung Galaxy S5. So, I should say I like the phone very much. There are only several minor drawbacks. For instance, this phone doesn't like the low quality chargers. The backlight of buttons, I cannot say I like it too much. It's comparatively dim and it's not so uniform. Then the camera, maybe it could be better with such a sensor and the dual flash, maybe the pictures could be better, but we can hope that they will be better in the future firmwares. The performance is very good, so no problems here at all. Among the drawbacks, another drawback is that maybe the light sensor is not so perfect and the electronic compass is also not so perfect, but they work actually and you may use them. Maybe again in the future firmwares they will be working better. Also the set is comparatively poor, so you only receive the charger and the charging cable. And sometimes you will receive the adapter. Charger is comparatively weak, it's only 1000 milliamperes, and they are white. Both cable and chargers are white, despite the phone itself is black, so maybe it's also a little drawback. But in all the other aspects, the phone is very good, the performance is good, the firmware is already quite nice, it's pre-rooted, screen is very nice, the touch screen is very nice, the amount of memory, both random access and flash memory, is nice, so it's quite okay. Navigation works perfectly, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth works perfectly, the phone calls are good, the data transfers through the cell networks are good, so it's all very good. So my opinion that the real value of this phone is higher than its value in dollars. So $180 for such a phone, it's a really good deal. So that's it. You can find all the links mentioned in the description to this video below. Now maybe a couple of words about the future. I hope that the next review will be released very soon, maybe in just several weeks, not half a year as the previous review. I hope that the situation in my country will become better, that the war will end, and wish you good luck. Goodbye.